Okay, I believe we have our guests on right now, so I'd like to welcome Bernie Dehler to our show. Bernie?
Yeah, thanks.
Good to have you with us. Just a little introduction for Bernie. He's a former born-again evangelical Christian, now a secular humanist and a poly-atheist, leaving belief in God just 3 years ago. Just briefly, what's a poly-atheist? I've heard of atheists, but is that many atheists?
Yeah, I'm glad you asked. It's kind of funny, actually. So basically, it means I don't just not believe in one God. I don't believe in any of all the gods that have ever claimed to existed. So, like a polytheist is one who believes in multiple gods. I believe multiple gods do not exist. So I'm a polyatheist. So it's kind of a play on it, really.
Oh, gee. Well, we might be similar on that. I'm a polyatheist in the sense that I don't believe in many gods either. So, point of agreement there.
In fact, that's kind of a famous thing where Richard Dawkins is a famous atheist. He says, you know, you and I are the same. It's just that I go one God further than you.
I've heard that one. Actually, I quote Richard Dawkins and some of my other, George Bernard Shaw, and some of my other favorite atheists a lot. All right. Bernie has a bachelor's degree from OIT, that's Oregon Institute of Technology, in electrical engineering. He has a master's degree from Luther Rice University in ministry. He works full-time as a computer chip designer. I know a lot of people in the area that does that. He organizes discussion groups, meetings on science and religion. He moderates and presents at many local religious debates and discussions. I want to say that we might have Bernie on again for a debate sometime. Today is more of a discussion. We're breaking in. Actually, last week I had a pretty lively debate with someone who we actually agreed on, but we took that format. But today we want to probe depth and get two different points of view. And then also, let's see, I think that's it. Our topic today is dealing with death, two views. So I want to get, and we've discussed the questions. We want to give ourselves a little chance to think about what we're dealing with. So, Bernie, I want to give you the chance to ask the first question. So go for it.
And by the way, too, I'll just bring up to you that I'm also a humanist minister, if that brings up some questions for you. Okay, we want to start with the question. So the first question I guess I would have for you is, do you accept the modern science of biology that we evolved from other animals? And the reason why I say this or ask this is because I think our origin story deeply affects our theology or our philosophy.
Okay, well, while it's not directly on death, and I am certainly no scientist, though I do appreciate a lot about science, the way I look at it is many of the so-called experts are not speaking from empirical evidence, but from theory. Science in its truest form is the discovery of natural truths, elements around us. Evolution seeks to skip the empirical part and give experts, so-called, that is best guess scenarios to events that they claim to be able to date back some gajillion years. Anyone who purports any alternative theory is simply dismissed as unenlightened, and sometimes even in the field of science, they're ridiculed. The reality of science is not making it out to be what we think it ought to be, but proving the facts that support our hypothesis. Evolution turns that idea on its head and says, here is what we need to have and had to have happened to make our theory correct. As much as these bloody experts howl and wail, that is not true science. Go ahead.
Well, I would say evolution is based on empirical data, especially some of the most amazing data for it comes from DNA, which since the year 2000, they sequenced the human genome, all the DNA in the humans, and then since then, they've also sequenced the DNA from numerous different species, and then they ran cross-checks, and they could actually see how the code has changed. And some of the code is kind of arbitrary. Like, there's more than one way to code something. There's no, like, correct way to code an amino acid sequence because there's different substitutions you could do. So there's no such thing as, like, a correct sequence. And it turns out that these animals all have similar codes, and you can see how they change, like, through the species. So, you know, as far as I'm concerned, if evolution did not happen, if we did not descend from other animals, then basically, you know, if God did create us from scratch, then he's purposely trying to mislead us, and that would make God a liar, which would not be an option for normal Christian theology.
Well, that's a good point. I would agree with you that God is not a liar according to the truth of the Bible. I guess the way I look at it, and I'm not a scientist, so I'm not the best to have an argument or debate in this area of evolution. I have a very good friend who does that all the time, who is an ordained minister and holds his own very well with scientists in those debates. But microbiology seems to disprove the premises of evolution. The amoeba, it did not evolve into a spirogyra. It absorbs food osmotically, suctions it in. It's quite a bit different than the spiral gyra that does that through motions. There's 49 proteins that all have to work at the same time. How do they all evolve right away in order for this to happen? It's kind of like the eyeball. How does a person gain sight through evolution in a gradual way? It just doesn't make sense. Whereas when you have and the geneticists, they have a lot of objection to punctuated equilibrium, which says, well, it happened quickly, just doesn't fit with geneticists. And then there's also the whole scenario about if there was evolution, why shouldn't we be able to, in our labs, create life? It has not actually happened. Anyway, we don't have time to go into too much depth on all these questions, but I want to get to the next question because we have several back and forth. So my question is...
Well, let me just do one follow-up because just to show about how it relates to death. I think the eyeball, for example, and the brain, you could look at and compare that across different animals and see how there's changes and maybe how it developed. And the way this relates to death is that if you have an evolutionary worldview, I mean, death is a natural part of life. There's nothing different going on there. And I'm assuming that you have a totally different view where you think God made, like, Adam and Eve, and they were perfect, and then they had a fall. So there was a perfect paradise where there was no death, and then death was introduced into the world after that. Is that a contrary view you have with for a different origin story than evolution? You believe in a special creation, and there was no death, and there was a paradise state?
Yes.
Okay, just clarifying.
I'm going to let you have the last word on that one. So, anyway...
I wanted to clarify that is because there's a lot of evangelicals now who do accept evolution, and they do accept that there was always death, and there was no paradise state, so I'm just trying to sort out which kind of Christian theology you have.
Okay, good. Are you afraid of death, and why or why not?
I'm not afraid of death so much. It's something I'm dealing with. There's actually a bigger problem. So, sorry, my phone interrupted me. I had the alarm go off. The way I see it is we are inbred with a survival instinct, and so it's very normal to fear the death, but there's this term called homunculus, which means little man, and people throughout history have thought there's a little man inside of us that sees things and makes decisions, but I think what we learned from neurology is there is no little man in us. Instead, the brain has all these different parts working in parallel, and many of our ideas are made subconsciously. And a lot of our decisions, because they're made subconsciously, we have the illusion of making conscious decisions sometimes. There have been science studies on this that they could even show that they could predict what a person's going to do before they do it, and the results are better than random. So basically, I have even more of a bigger problem than death, essentially, is what I'm getting to. And that is, see, the fear of death is like the fear of your loss of yourself. But my problem is thinking, what is yourself? And when you consider neurology and how our brain processes, this is a big area of scientific study. So my so I'm not afraid of death so much because I'm not really even so sure that this, you know, this little me exists. I mean, this is what they call the homunculus. It's a little man inside. I don't believe in that. I think we just have the brain. And so I'm trying to understand consciousness and what that means. And so I'm just kind of seeing myself in the life cycle of the Earth and the universe, and just trying to understand basically what reality is. And when I was a Christian, I didn't have to think about any of this because it was very simplistic, like, oh, you know, you're a person, you have a soul, when you die, you go to heaven, and, you know, there's nothing more to think about. But since I jettisoned all that, so now I'm really looking into what is reality. So I'm really blossoming scientifically because I'm trying to research this stuff.
Well, that was kind of complicated for me, to be honest. I feel bad for you a little bit. You've lost the simplicity. And by the way, we've kind of crossed trails. I grew up. You're a former Christian. I'm a former non-Christian. I went 24 years as an unbeliever, and it was complicated for me, and it was rather fearful, the whole complexity. And I studied psychology, studied some of the things about the mind, and actually the soul. The word psychology, by the way, means the study of the soul. I think to be really qualified in that, one needs to have an idea of what the soul is. But I guess I feel bad that you haven't resolved that thing that all of us face. It's one of the biggest things. I mean, the two biggest events, even bigger than marriage, though that's a big one, but is our birth and our death. All the rest is what we do in between. But we are launched into life, and then we're launched out. And without any kind of hope, or it seems like there's a natural born fear anyway that people have of death. We have the love for life, the desire that I believe God put into us. But to have that ultimate fear where there's nothing, that's sad.
Well, you said you feel sorry for me. So have you heard of Plato's cave analogy?
Yeah, I have. You can remind me. It's been quite a bit of time. Did that have something to do with the ideal and all that?
Well, basically, Plato says there's this, imagine this scene where people are chained with their backs against a wall, and all they can do is see forward. And all they're doing is, when they see forward, is they see shadows on a wall, and there's a fire behind them with people with puppets and stuff, and they're putting shadows on the wall. And these people who are watching this think that's reality, but it's not. And what happens is if somebody can break free and see that and see what the real reality is, and maybe even get on the surface of the earth and see real reality, then they have an awakening and they see what real life is. And if they come back down and try to talk to the other people are going to say, oh, well, that's sad, you're crazy, you don't really understand what's going on here. And so this is a story about how the philosopher needs to try to come back off his perch and try to talk to the common folk and stuff. And so I kind of feel like that's how I am, is when I left religion, I had a simplistic idea of what is existence, what is the soul, what is life, and all that. But as I broke free from all that, and I'm just exploring all this, the scientific, like what makes our brain work, what is, you know, neuroscience telling us, and this reality is a lot stranger than these simple ideas that people just get from common sense, because common sense is so wrong on so many things scientific. Like, you know, with common sense, nobody would think that the earth is spinning 1,000 miles an hour, but it is, you know, but you don't feel it. I mean, it's just against your common sense, and that's the way the brain is, and so much science.
I do remember studying about the earth spinning. Actually, I think there's something in the Bible that talks about how our planet works, but we don't need to get into that now. It's your turn for your second question.
Okay, so my second question to you is, do you think there's any good evidence for an afterlife?
That's a good question. It depends on what you mean. Speaking of the complicated brain, good evidence sounds good, if that's what you're really asking, as opposed to proof beyond a shadow of the doubt, because there's a big difference between the two. There's plenty of areas of life that we take on faith, which we can say is based on good evidence. It can't be proved beyond a shadow of a doubt, like friendships, relationships, cars or things that we buy and acquire, things like that. If somebody was going to go into a new romantic relationship, there's going to be a certain amount of faith. They'll go on the best evidence, but not something that's beyond a shadow of a doubt. In the end, you can live with someone for 20 years and then find out that there's things and new surprises about that person. You could buy a new car wanting good proof, but that's not, that it's not a lemon, but that doesn't mean that you have absolute proof. There are some decisions we make that we take in consideration our gut feeling or, something like that. So is there any good evidence? C.S. Lewis, one of my favorite books is Mere Christianity. I love that book. And in that, he talked about appetites and how that has good evidence that there is something beyond this life. In other words, we all recognize that we have an appetite or a hunger for food, and that appetite has a way of finding fulfillment in eating food. We have, in a sense, an appetite for rest, and sleep provides us with that. We have lots of different appetites. In relationship, which I mentioned, there's an appetite there, and that has a vehicle for fulfillment. There's an innate appetite in most people for something that goes beyond just the everyday mundane world or life that we live today, and yet where is that satisfied? It can never be satisfied in this world, that appetite for something that's more eternal. And that gives us some good evidence. Beyond a shadow of a doubt? No. It leaves it up to our imagination a little bit, which I think makes us appreciate it more and have more ownership.
Well, let me ask you a follow-up information about this imagination thing, imagination versus truth. So do you just by way of labels, do you call yourself an evangelical Christian? Is that how you associate yourself?
I'm not against that. I'm actually a Jesus freak. That's my actual label.
Okay, so let me ask you a detail about this as far as the imagination or real life or evidence. So if you consider, Catholics say they are Christians, Mormons say they are Christians, and you might say, well, both of them are wrong. And just to briefly say, for example, the Catholics have details about the afterlife. They have purgatory. And what is a venial sin that gets you into purgatory, or what's a mortal sin, which means you're going to hell, you don't even go to purgatory? And then how do you get out of purgatory through indulgences, and how much power these indulgences they have? They have a handbook of indulgences that say, whether they're plenary or partial, full or partial. And then the Mormons, for example, they have temple rites where they have secret passwords and stuff to get through the eternal veil. They have baptism for the dead because they think the dead in the spirit world can make a decision for Christ if they can't get baptized, so they got to baptize in proxy here. These are a lot of different details. Each one is different. The Mormon is different than the Catholic, and you're different than both of those. Where do you think these are coming from? Are these just from the imagination?
I read about Julius Caesar in a history book, and most people accept that. Because there's a lot of evidence of historical records of Julius Caesar's life, as well as literature. History is part of facts, by the way, in my view. I respect that. I respect the history of our country. I'm a student of history, and I respect the history of England. I also, I'm a Jewish person, born and raised Jewish. I respect the history that goes back to Moses and Abraham and all the way back, and also about Jesus Christ. So I view that as as fact. There's historical records, and without going into a debate about the veracity of the Bible, that would be a good discussion sometime. The Bible has been shown to be so much more accurate than most of the historical records of the ancient world. It has so many more copies and so much fewer questionable things that people question about it. So I guess what I'm saying is that I go by the Holy Scriptures. And when the Catholics do indulgences, or they did, they don't do that anymore.
No, they do that.
Well, it's not like it was during the time of the Reformation. So that's a deviation. That's a perversion of the gospel. And the Mormons, some of their theories, for instance, that you're going to remain married forever to a wife, is directly contradicted by the most brilliant mind with the most brilliant brain of all times, named Jesus Christ, when he said, after death, we're not given to that kind of thing. And that actually kind of leads us to the next question that I have, and that is kind of turning it around. How do you know?
Before we go there, can I just ask a follow-up question on that, just so we don't leave things hanging?
Okay.
Indulgences are part of the Catholic Catechism. If you go to Catholic.com, for example, they have a whole page about what it is, and you can even buy a handbook of indulgences, and this is still taught in the Catholic Catechism. So there's a whole worked-out theory about purgatory and how to get out of purgatory with indulgences. And so I guess I'd like maybe a clear answer from you. Since this is so detailed about the ultimate life and you reject this and Mormons reject this, where do you think this is coming from? Is it just the imagination? Because they seriously believe in this theology, and they say they're the true church, and this is true teaching.
Well, it doesn't come from Christ, and that's the problem. And that's where we have, the facts of what happened in history, the fact that Jesus died on the cross and rose from the dead, and that his followers, that they would be fanatics to preach that and die for it. Why would you die for something, not even a belief, but an actual occurrence where 500 people witnessed it? Where the Catholic Church goes is people, when they lose that freshness of actual truth and the actual experience of Jesus Christ, what happens is that things start to degenerate, and then it does turn into religion. And by the way, I'm probably just as non-religious as you are in that sense. So Catholicism was steeped in religion. It did not attract me at all to anything regarding God, though I will say that it was a Catholic that led me to Christ, and there are many Catholics that are genuine believers. But as a whole cloth theology, there's a lot of holes, and there's a lot of complications and confusions. So I would agree with you on that part of it. So back to my question, how do you know, how can you prove that death is the cessation of being? And I'm just anticipating part of your answer. Brain waves and the body isn't the whole story. I think you know that since you were a Christian, or at least that's what you say that you are. And I'm only saying that not because I don't believe you, but some people have the belief that you can never be a former Christian. I figure it's up to each person to make up their mind on that one. But how do you really know that there is a cessation of being and that there is nothing after death?
Well, there's a bigger question here is how do you know anything really? And the way I see it is that everything we know comes through induction and deduction. Everything. There's two other possible ways that some people claim to get information. One is divine revelation. Either God told them or God told somebody else, and you should believe them. That's a prophet. And the other way people think they get knowledge is through feelings. Like, I just think this is the right answer from feelings. Okay, so I say everything is through induction and deduction. Now, with induction and deduction, we look at the world and say, let's try to make sense of the world. And we see how the brain develops, and we see how it dissipates. In old age, people go into dementia. When a person is first conceived, they have no brain. There's just an egg. and it's fertilized by a sperm cell. That becomes one cell, that goes to 2, that goes to 4, that goes to 8, that goes to 16. There is no nerve cell yet. So there's no synapses, there's no brain, there's no thinking going on. And as the brain develops, the thinking arises from that. So when you put everything together from what you observed, you can create a hypothesis. When you look at the whole world and put ideas together, that's called abduction. And so you put together what's the best fit explanation for everything. So it just makes perfect sense that when you die, that's it. Mark Twain said, hey, I was non-existent billions of years before I was conceived, so that didn't seem to hurt me much. So it's like, I'm just going back to where I came from, nothing.
We're going to have to go to a break. We're already past time for that. And then we'll be back with Bernie Dehler, who is our guest. He is an atheist, a former Christian, a polytheist, I guess. He prefers that designation, which is fine with me. So, and I have a follow-up question for what his comments were just now. So we'll be back with you in just a moment.
Volunteer at Pregnancy Resource Centers of the Greater Portland Area, urging you to join me in caring for our community together. Portland PRC is committed to serving women like Krista.
I found out that I was pregnant my senior year in high school. Emotionally, it was like a whirlwind. I went to get an ultrasound, and you could see a perfect profile of Amanda's face. It became more real. Just the realization that I was going to be bringing a child into the world.
This year, more than 8,000 women will come to PRC in need of a pregnancy test, an ultrasound, practical help, or simply someone to listen. Your gift today will provide this valuable service. Just $45 gives new parents a free ultrasound and the first photo of their unborn baby.
If PRC hadn't been there 18 years ago, my daughter Amanda would not be alive and doing mission work in Africa right now.
Every life story needs the chance to begin. Let's impact lives today. Go to portlandprc.org and click donate now. That's portlandprc.org.
This is Rick Livingston with the Counsel Here Show. Our guest today is Bernie Dehler, a polytheist and also a professing former Christian. For follow-up on what we were talking about, there was some science being brought up here about death. Anyway, I guess I see that you mentioned the deductive and inductive method of getting information and having basically awareness of things. I'm great on inductive and deductive. My Bible study method generally is inductive. Even today, there was a little bit of that in the beginning. Deductive reasoning, I like to start with premises and work with it. I've studied the science and the art of psychology. I practice it. I've been practicing it for a long time, and a lot of that has to be used. I've read the life story of Isaac Newton, who's called by some possibly the most brilliant man who ever lived, rated even higher than Einstein by many. This man was also very adamant, passionate Christian, and yet it didn't have a problem with his scientific notions. A lot of information can be deduced and induced from the Holy Scriptures. There's much science in the Scriptures. There's much literature in the Scriptures. There's history, and it's been borne out. There's been cross connections. And one thing that impresses me is the psychology of Scripture. I've seen it over and over again in my life. And also having experience with the Holy Spirit, actually entering into a new world, which Jesus talks about, and then actually experiencing what the Bible actually speaks about. Not only that, but lest I be the only crazy person on the earth, and depending on my own experience and the Bible and the Word of God, there's so many other people that I have talked with and read about and who have had similar experiences. And then also concerning death, there's people that have actually experienced that and come back from the dead. So I find it not a place where it's just some kind of phantasmagorical fairy tale nuance of the mind, but there's an overwhelming amount of agreement there by many people. What do you have to say to that, Bernie?
You say that, you know, you rely on induction and deduction, and that's good. And I would say, you know, to intelligently talk about these things, those are the places we want to go. You mentioned Newton was a believer, too. Well, that was, I'm kind of foggy now on his timing, but I think that was way before Darwin. Even when Darwin went on his Beagle trip, his famous voyage, he went on there as a creationist. And then Darwin still wasn't an atheist. In fact, during that time, Huxley was called Darwin's bulldog, and he invented the word agnosticism. So, and Darwin, I think, even said that he thought God breathed life into the original living cells, and from there all life emanated. So, I would think if Newton were alive today, I mean, he may very well be like Darwin and change his mind with the evidence. But one thing I want to mention, too, is as far as stories, as a counselor, too, I mean, you can do scientific studies on that, and I would consider that a part of induction. But I would say there is a danger if you just listen to one person's story, because that could be anecdotal evidence that could be really overblown. You know, like you can believe almost anything by hearing just one story, you know, ghost stories, Santa stories, whatever. Sometimes people just, you know, they clean up the story and they don't tell you the whole thing. So anecdotal evidence is something that's often misunderstood for real evidence. It's basically one data point, and it's not seen in scale of all the data. So if you're a counselor and you do a study, a scientific study, that's good evidence, you know, and you're doing statistical analysis on it. But it's very dangerous to have one story and say, like, for example, here's a report of a miracle, you know, and my gosh, that's proof of God, you know.
You make good points. Actually, the Bible would agree with you that it says not one story, but in the mouth of two or three witnesses. You're probably familiar with that with your degree in ministry. Out of the mouth of two or three witnesses, and I think that's symbolic. It could be, in some senses, more than that. In fact, actually, there's about 40 witnesses that wrote the Holy Scriptures. It's called the Bible, the book, but it's actually the book of books. It's 66 books, and there's a lot of testimony there over a period of 2,000 years. So I would agree with you that, we want to have more than just one anecdotal story. There's multiple millions upon millions. The people that are dying and that are being persecuted in China, there's as many Christians apparently in China as there are here in the United States, and they're willing to die for their faith because of what they believe. And they're not afraid of death because they know that they have a reward afterwards, which I was talking about a little bit in 1 Corinthians chapter 15. You mentioned Darwin. This one I'm going to take a little bit of a type of maybe on it, but there are stories that Darwin actually himself changed his mind. I don't think Newton necessarily would have to change his mind. Einstein himself actually made statements in his life of how it would be incredible to not believe in God with the evidence that he has seen. And you mentioned Huxley. Now, I'm not sure which Huxley you're describing, but I read The Brave New World. I love that book. Aldous Huxley wrote a book that I think tops 1984 for terror, because it's a story about what life would be like without God and without the values that come from the Christian faith, and that is there's no family, children are marginalized, and human life is definitely cheapened, which is interesting because the value of life has huge in my Jewish faith as I was growing up, and also reaffirmed in the Christian faith, though eternal life even supersedes that.
Well, one comment I'd like to make too is, like, you know, you introduced me as an atheist. There's a better label because, you know, calling me an atheist would be like calling you a theist. You know, it doesn't really say, you know, specifically you're a Christian. And I believe that there should be a replacement philosophical system, and that's basically known as secular humanism, which is a positive expression. Because
okay.
Atheism doesn't really say a whole lot. I mean, for example, you can believe reincarnation and still be an atheist. Atheist just means you don't believe in God. So a positive expression would be secular humanism. So anyway, I just wanted to, when you said Thomas Huxley said, you know, what would a life without God be like? Well, I would say, let's look at secular humanism and see what it wants to propose. And I think secular humanism is in its infancy, so it's, you know, it's still trying to get off its training wheels, you know, as far as a movement.
Well, I've been hearing about secular humanism for the last 40 years, since the 70s, so that would be one I would love to have a discussion with you about, the whole idea of secular humanism. I think that's even more interesting than this. You picked this topic, by the way, folks out here. Just want to let you know, it was Bernie's choice.
Yeah.
I said, what do you want to talk about? And I respect him for that. And also, I regard him, I don't know him very well, but he came highly recommended by a Christian minister, a missionary, and he seems to be a very respectful gentleman. I appreciate having this dialogue with him. We're not going to have time to get to everything, but let's get to your third question, and maybe we can go a little shorter on these, because I would like to touch on each one of these, at least to stimulate the minds of people. So your third question
okay.
for me.
Okay. So I like this this idea of going through these stages of grieving, because for me, this is, you know, kind of going against what I just said earlier. For me, this is kind of anecdotal evidence. For me, this seems to make sense, but there's this theory that people deal with grieving by going through these stages of denial, then anger, negotiation, depression, and finally acceptance.
Mm-hmm.
And for me, it seems like we need to do the same thing with death. We need to get through the denial, anger, negotiation, depression, to finally get to acceptance. I think religious people are still stuck in the denial stage because they believe in this afterlife. They're not dealing with reality. So I wanted to see what your viewpoint on that was.
Well, you know, we might be able to shorten our time on this one question, because I'm going to ask you a counter question, my number three question. We did not consult on these ahead of time, as far as he did not know what questions I was going to ask, and I had already prepared mine when he sent his. My number three question is, what comfort would you give to a parent who has lost a teenage child to death? So how would you get him out of denial?
Oh, well, see, I would say if a person is dealing with death, the best thing to do is just be a friend to him at that point. It's not a time to try to teach him or straighten him out or anything. Just be a friend.
So I guess I put my hand on his shoulder and say, you're my friend. Don't worry about your kid that died. It doesn't really matter at all. And I know you wouldn't put it that way, but isn't that the kind of a message I'm getting, that there's no comfort for you except the fact that I'm your friend? But as far as your son, you know, you're just going to have to be miserable about the whole thing.
Well, you know, to say, like, you know, as far as, you know, you're going to be miserable or whatever, that'd be me trying to teach him something. So it'd be, like I said, better to be a friend and just say, like, yeah, he was a great person. Look what he did. We can reminisce. Yes, I understand you miss him. You know, I miss him too. Just let the grieving process without trying to teach him something. You know?
I would say.
And some people have said it's really bad. I mean, it's bad advice to give him. I mean, I can't, you know, do what I would consider lying and say he's in a better place or something.
That's a good point. People can sometimes be heartless and give very surfacey comfort that doesn't recognize the grief the person's going through. On the other hand, we that might be more skillful might be able to help point them in a direction, at least. So I think it's great that you would be a good friend. I really do. And I think it's important that we can come alongside. That's a biblical concept. It's called parakaleo, which is one of the words for counseling, which is to come alongside of. It comes from Paracletus, which is the Holy Spirit, who is the comforter. But there is a comfort, and there is something that can help bring, by pointing and asking the right questions or directing the person a little bit, not so much teaching them. That has kind of a pedantic sound to it, you know, sort of a naggish, hit over the head type of sound. But I think that as Christians, we have something a little bit more to offer than just, okay, I'm your buddy. And believe me, we have great fellowship, me with some of my friends, close friends and buddies, but I want to give them something more. I want them to be able to feel the comfort that comes, that not just from me, but from God himself. And there's ways to be able to relate that to people as a friend without lecturing them, without being pedantic or doing a mind trip teaching thing.
Yeah, well, with your beliefs, you have a superior position because you can tell them something they want to hear that's good. I mean, for example, if I said Santa Claus was real, well, for, you know, if I told a kid that Santa Claus is real and I really believed it, that'd be a better message for the kid than you saying, look, you know, Santa's not real, get in reality, you know.
So, if you're compared God, Jesus Christ, to Santa Claus, you've already lost a lot of people, including myself. That, you know, the whole idea of Santa Claus was always in the myth thing. It came from a person who was called a saint, but Nicholas, but that's hardly comparable. So anyway, but
with my worldview, they're exactly the same. They're both fiction to the same extent.
Well, yeah, that's true. Well, anyway, I don't want to, into that denial, because you did ask me, I like Proverbs 28:13. Proverbs 28:13 says, he that covers his sin shall not prosper. That's denial, covering one's sin. That's what Adam did. He covered it. He got a fig leaf and covered it. He went and hid. He blamed that woman and blamed God, who you gave me. Lots of denial in Adam. And that's been the human race ever since. The psychology of the Bible is just astounding. He that covers his sin shall not prosper, but whoever confesses and forsakes it will find mercy. And so I find denial is something that's so rampant among people without that worldview of accountability to something beyond just ourselves. You know, hey, Bernie, I just noticed that we have a caller here, I'd like to catch this and see what question they might have for either you or me. So, caller, you're on the air. If you could give us your first name and what state you're calling from. I've got somebody here, but they have an answer. I believe they're on the air. Is there somebody out there, or do we need to... Hello? Okay, well, for some reason, maybe they're not catching it, so we'll have to forego that call. Did you have a last comment to what I had just said, Bernie?
No, we can move on if you want to do it. You had one more question, I think?
Yeah, but it was your turn, because I asked, I think it's your turn, the last question from you.
So basically, my last question was, how can we have a soul, or this what's called homunculus, this little person inside of us who figures out everything and makes these decisions. How could we have this this self kind of person when we know from neurology there's no central part of the brain overlooking everything? Instead, there's all these different parallel processes going on, and even a lot of subconscious processing going on, and studies have shown that we make these subconscious ideas and later on attribute them to our idea that we consciously made when we really subconsciously made them.
Good question. The argument is to define the soul, it's been going on for a long time, and the best of minds have been disagreeing on many of the points about that. The Bible actually agrees with you. When I was working on my master's degree in counseling through the seminary, I noticed that they took a view that was very inductive from the scripture. It wasn't just the regular, I guess it's called trilateral or whatever, triunal, of man being spirit, soul, and body. So it would just be this inner soul. But it talked about different things. There was the soul mentioned. There was the spirit of man, which is different than the Holy Spirit. Like Romans 8:16, the spirit bears witness with our spirit that we are the sons of God. That's speaking of people that have been born again. There was the heart, then there's the mind, and the Greek concept of the mind is quite different. And then there was the kibbah, or where Phineas ended the plague by putting a spear through the kibbah of two people that were in deep sin, leaders, and thereby making peace in the camp. And Jesus talked about that with the Greek word. I can't remember what that word is, but... comparable to the Kabbalah, that out of it will flow rivers of living water. So where is the central part of man? Is it in his brain? Is it in his heart? Is it in his gut? Somewhere in the belly, out of the belly? I believe that it's the overall soul / spirit, the spirit being the part that sees man. There's the view of we see the world through our body. We see things about ourselves through the soul. We see things about the eternal and God through our spirit. So there isn't one part. I would agree with that. But there is this sense of our animating force. And I don't see where we have any of that in terms of it's something that we've never been able to find. Scientists admit, they even admit they can't say what happened before the beginning of time. They can't explain even their own evolution. They can't explain the human mind because there's a certain part of it that is intangible. Bernie, your last comment.
Well, yeah, scientists can't explain a lot of things because we're still researching. I mean, in human evolution, it wasn't that long ago where Neanderthal couldn't explain what caused the earthquakes or what caused lightning. You know, maybe the gods are angry at us and they're trying to punish us. Well, now we know it's plate tectonics or electrical differences. So, you know, it's come a long way.
Well, science will discover many things, and it's a great thing. I am no enemy of science. Science, the universities were mostly founded here in the United States, and a lot of science, the heritage is actually looking at history through Christian thinking. I think it still exists. But anyway, Bernie, I want to thank you for being on the show. We'll have to do this again sometime. Is there a website that you want to promote for people to be able to go to get more information from you?
I guess probably the best place to go is if you go to meetup.com. Meetup.com is a general website that you can put in any kind of interest, like if you like riding horses or collecting stamps or whatever, and if you put in atheist or Christian in the search engine there in the Portland area, then my groups will pop up. There's a West Side Science and Religion Discussion Group and a Vancouver Science and Religion Discussion Group, and you can see the events we're doing. We're doing local debates and things like that, Christians and atheists.
All right. Well, Bernie, once again, I appreciate you being on the show, and this has been really special for me, a little bit different format than usual. I wasn't the only one asking the questions. We're cross-firing here a little bit. So, anyway, I'd say God bless you, but you wouldn't go with that, but I respect... Oh, and the secular humanist, that will be the title. I didn't know that that's how you want to go by, but if we have you on again, I'd love to talk about that.
Yeah, that's a good topic, actually.
Okay. Well, you take care. Bye.
All right.